So in today's class, we will be learning following topics. So first will be types of function calling. Next will be nested function. Third will be scope rules. Okay, and fourth will be our first project that we are going to discuss, that is handling school database project. Okay, so in our course lecture, there will be at least 5 projects. Okay, so this is our first project that will be that we will complete in the 2 to 3 days. Okay, so in the functions part, we have currently recursive functions, that is the very important functions that is remaining. And in the previous class, I told you that I am going to teach you data algorithm parts, means searching and sorting in Python. But we have lots of dependency of recursive functions on that, so that I didn't cover that. So so firstly we will cover the recursive function, then we will go to the data structures, and means searching and sorting, means this searching and sorting for Python. Okay, so so before going to that, first we will discuss what are types of function calling. So on the basis of function calling, you know that first part in the function is, you define a function, then you use that function. So using that function is called as calling function. Okay, so for calling function, what we do, we basically give the name of the function, and then we pass all the parameters, all the arguments that was supposed to pass in the function. So as I given you the example of calculate area, that calculate area function were using 2 parameters, length and width, and it was returning area. So length and width were the arguments that you need to pass when you call the function, otherwise your function cannot be called. Okay, so there are basically 2 ways of function calling. So first is direct calling. Okay, so you can see that what we do in the direct calling is, suppose that we have a function that add 2 numbers. Okay, we pass 2 numbers, first number and second number in the function, and it returns the sum of 2 numbers. Okay, so when you call the function like that, means when you give the name of the function and then you are passing the 2 arguments, first number and second function. Okay, so this type of calling is the function, it is called as direct calling. Okay, now we have indirect calling. So indirect calling, we don't actually call the same function by their name. What we do there means we give a different name to the function. Okay, like you can see that we have add 2 numbers as a function, and we defined a new variable function is equal to add 2 numbers. Now we are calling this variable. This variable will behave like the same function, but this is called as indirect calling. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you can ask me, what is the benefit of doing that? Okay. So suppose that, what can we do here? Suppose that we have some function that has very big name. Okay. So that for that function, we can give a sort name to that function, and then we can call that function by their sort names. Okay. So this is one benefit of calling function by indirect calling method. And next can be means next is if you want to means hide the information of the function, means if you want to hide the information, means like exact information about the function, is what is the name of that function, is for the hiding purpose, you can also give a name to the function, and then you can call the function indirectly. So these are some rules of the functions, function calling. Next is, so I am giving you first the example of this. Yes, sure, you can write. So I am giving you the example first. So can anyone convey in the group that we are going to discuss the project so that everybody should join? Is anybody convey the message? Yeah, and meanwhile we also try to have our solution of the assignment 3 that is currently pending from my side. So we will also try to have the solution of that. So first suppose that I am creating a function def and then add two numbers or like add numbers, okay, and this is taking two arguments, first number and the second number. Yeah, one very important thing regarding the function is always follow the rules while creating the variable like this. Okay, you can see that when I am giving the name of the function, all the if the function is having two words, then I am using a space, means underscore here. Okay, similarly in case of variables, means in case of parameters also, in the parameter name you can see that if we have two words in the parameter, then we are joining two words by underscore. So this is the means the best practice that we need to follow while working with Python. Okay, so suppose that we have a function add two numbers and we are returning here first number plus second number. Okay, now suppose that firstly we are calling this by print and then add two numbers. We need to pass here two parameters. Suppose that we are passing here 1 1, then it will return what? It will return 2. Okay, now meanwhile we are also creating a second, so this is called what? This is direct calling now. We are going to see indirect calling. You can see that if we write here print add numbers and then sorry means firstly we are creating a second variable sum numbers is equal to add numbers and then we are calling this sum numbers and we are passing here two arguments 1 and 2. Will give the same out. It is giving you 3. So this is called what? This is indirect calling. I hope all of you understand. Now somebody asks me, suppose that if I write here print x is equal to print. Okay. Now write x. You can see that you can use the print function now by this hello, by this x variable. It is clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, next topic is nested functions. Okay, so what are nested functions? So nested functions are very means I think we have seen nested function lots of means not nested functions. We have seen this concept of nesting in lots of previous lectures, like in case of list, in case of loops, in case of conditional statement. So everywhere nesting is present. Okay, so now we will also see nesting nested function. So a nested function is a function which is defined within another function, then or you can see that you can say that the enclosing function. So suppose that we want to write a function to calculate the area and sum of perimeter of a rectangle. What we want? We want to write a function that basically do what? It gives you the sum of area and perimeter of a rectangle. So of course we need to pass here length and width, okay, length and breadth or length and width, anything you can say. So now here you can see that we are creating two functions inside this function. Okay, so now we are creating def calculate area. Okay, now this calculate area is taking two arguments L and B, and it is returning L star B. That is basically the area. Next is calculate perimeter. So again we are defining a function inside this function calculate perimeter, and here we are passing L and B, and then we are returning 2 star L plus B. Okay, now you can see that we can call this function by inside this. So we are returning a return calculate area length star width plus calculate perimeter length and width we are passing here. So these two functions we are calling inside this function. Okay, so now you can see that, so this function calculate area and calculate perimeters are inside another function that is called as nested functions. Okay, so the rule of calling will be the same, but only difference is they are inside a function. That's why it is called as nested functions. So now one different thing is you can call this function. Okay, so if you call calculate sum of area and perimeter of rectangle, then it will automatically call this function and it will return you the result. Okay, so now you can see that. Suppose that we want to write the same program def get area and get area and perimeter sum. Okay. And now here we are passing two things, length and then. Now we are defining two functions inside this def and then get area, and here we are passing L and W. Okay, and then we are return L star W. we are writing def and then get parameter. And here we are passing again the length and width, and now we are returning return 2 star L plus W. Okay. Now you can see that if we write here return this get area and perimeter sum will be what? First we will get the area by calling this function get area. And get area, and then here we need to pass length and W. Okay, so we have length and width value that is coming from here, so we can write here the length and width value plus what? Get parameter. Yes, here we need to again pass the length and width, so we will pass here these values length and width. You can call this function def get area, and suppose that we are writing result is equal to get. Yeah, and suppose that here we are passing 4 and 5. And now, if you print the result, then you will get 38. Okay, now here you can see that if I ask you, these gate area and gate perimeters are what? They are nested functions. Okay, now one very important thing here is you can see that this gate area and gate perimeter will be only available inside. Okay, reference of this gate area and gate perimeter will be only available inside this function. You cannot call this gate area and gate perimeter outside this function. Okay, if you try to write area is equal to gate area, then you cannot write area is equal to and then gate area. You cannot call. You can see that it is not available. So this gate area and gate perimeters are local to these functions. So now the what is the concept of local and global, I will explain. So this is the problem here. So if you call any function inside, and if you create any function inside another function, then you cannot call that function directly. Only this function can call that function. Is this clear, everyone? So you can ask me, what is the benefit of creating nested function? So the benefit of nested function is, so suppose that you want to create some computational task. That means if you have a big task, you can see that gate area and perimeter sum can be divided into two subtasks to get. Firstly, we will get the area and we will get the perimeter. So maintaining this code is really very easy. So suppose that if you only want to change the logic of get area, then we will only work with this. Or if you want to get the, means if you want to work with the perimeter only, then we need to change this logic only. So this is just suppose that if we have some big task and we want to handle that task in sub format, then we can use the nested function. Otherwise, nested function has no role, means no importance. Okay, so and it is also means not a good practice to create a nested function in the program. We try to avoid nested functions. Okay, even in a big projects, we don't have nested function. Means if you create a large enterprise application, then it is recommended that we should not create nested functions. Okay, so just for the knowledge purpose, I am giving you the example of this, that you can do that. So is this clear, everyone? Do you have any doubt or any questions related to this?
It's clear. Thank you.
Okay. Now I told you, means we cannot call this function calculate area and calculate perimeter outside the function. So these concepts are basically handled by scope rules. So scope rules are what? Scope rules are just, it is the rule that tells that which variables are present where, means which variables can be accessed where. Okay, so there are two scope basically. First is called as global scope and second is called as local scope. So global scope is something, some variables, okay, variables, function or class that are available everywhere. Okay, so if you create some variable outside any function, okay, outside any function, then that variable will be always available to and always available globally. Now if you will see the example of that, what I am going, means what I am basically telling you. Next is local scope. So local scope is what? Any variable defined inside a function body is local and it is accessible to that function only. So global scope is what? If any variable is outside a function, then it will be a global scope, means it will be a global variable so that you can call that function anywhere, means you can access that variable anywhere. So what is local scope? Local scope is if any variable is created inside a function, then that variable will have only, means access of that to that function only. Okay, so this is called a local scope. So just if variable is outside function, then it is global. If variable is inside a function, then it is local. So there are two rules. So suppose that I am just giving you the example of this. Okay, so before going to example of this, I am just giving you how the scope rules work. Means suppose that if you want to access any variable, so what Python does to find that variable in the scope. Scope is means the whole program scope, means variable can be present anywhere. So scope is just your whole program. Okay, so now if you access a variable, then first Python tries to find that variable into the local scope. So what will be the local scope? So if you are calling the variable in the function, then first Python try to find that variable inside the function only. If that variable is not present inside the function, then it will check for that variable outside the function, means the global scope. If that variable is also not present in the global scope, then Python will try to find that variable inside, Python will try to find that function outside the global scope, means that will be built-in functions. So at the end, Python will look for the built-in functions. So built-in functions are those functions that is provided by Python. So now we are going to see the scope rule. So suppose that first we have two variables, x is equal to 2. Okay, and here we have supported a function, it just print a message. Now here we have x is equal to 3. Okay, so now we have defined x is equal to 2 and inside this function we have defined x is equal to 3. Okay, now print x, what will you get? You are getting 2. So that 2 is coming from here. Okay, now suppose that Yes, okay. So this is So first I am going to give you the example of local and global scope. Okay, so you can see that this x is equal to 2 is present outside the function, then it is what? This is, it is global variable. Okay, and global variable, what global variable? I told you that global variable can be accessed anywhere. Okay, now suppose that we have one more global variable, that is y is equal to 2. Okay, now if you write in your program print hello x and then y, okay. Now we are doing what? We are, before going to that, you can see that this x is present here, this x is present inside this function, then it is what? It is local variable, and local variable can be accessed in the function only. It cannot be accessed outside the function. So if you want to check this, suppose that here we have x is equal to 2, y is equal to 2 and z is equal to 3. Okay, if you try to get the access of this outside this function, if you try to print that, then it will give you error. That is not defined. So that is present inside this. So this is local to this function only. So this function has the only access of this. So you can see that it is giving you the error, undefined variable z. Now so this z is what? This z is local to print message function. Is we have written here x, y. So here we never defined the y inside this function. So I told you what. So if you call this function print print message, okay. You call this function print message, you can see that it is printing you 2 and 2. So this x is coming from here and this y, means x is coming from here and y is coming from here. So this x and y are global, that's why they can be called inside this function. Okay, they have the, so this, that's why this print message function has the access of x and y, because these are global variables. Okay, so I think the concept of global and local variables are clear to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we have discussed about this. Okay, so firstly the variable is looked inside the local scope, then it is looked outside the local scope, that is basically the global scope, then it is looked outside the global scope, that is the built-in. So firstly local, then global, then built-in. So I am giving the practical example of that. So suppose that you have created a function here, def and then print. Okay, and here in this print we are just printing, suppose that or some message, suppose that will come. So we have created a function print. Okay, now okay, so we are not doing this, means we are returning here return welcome only. So we are returning welcome here. So this print is doing what? It is returning you welcome. Now if you call result is equal to, and print, okay, and here So now we are writing here result is equal to print. Okay, it is not returning anything, but you can see that this print was what? This print was a built-in function. Okay, now if you print the result, what it is doing? It is telling you print function takes zero positional argument, means this print function is now not available to us. So that was the built-in function. So I told you what Python does. Firstly, it looks into the local scope, then global scope. So Python basically, when you call this print function, so Python first try to find that in the global scope. So it then find that function. So so the definition of the function was what? This function was not taking any argument. So that's why it is giving you the error. Okay. Now Python is not looking for this function in the global scope. So in the built-in function. So you know that this print is a built-in function. In this print, if you pass anything, then it should print that. But it is currently not printing. Why? Because this print is coming from the global scope, not from the built-in scope. Is this clear, everyone?
It's fine.
If you have any doubt in the scope rule, then you it should be very clear to you.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. Now we are moving to the topic. Okay, so before going to the project, we have one thing that is pending, that was recursive functions. Okay. So first we will cover the recursive function, then we will go to the project part. So what is recursive function? I have already given you the explanation of that. A recursive function is a function that calls itself. Okay. So in that recursive function, we have one very important thing that is called a base case. So base case is one critical requirement for recursive function to terminate. That is basically the termination point of the function. So every recursive function should have a base case. Why? Because you know that what in the recursive function, I told you that function calls itself. So if function calls itself, then again that function will call itself, and what will happen? This will create an infinite loop. Okay, so to avoid the infinite loop, we need to stop that looping at any place. So that is done by using the base case. Okay, so and these recursive functions are really very important. It is applied in the lots of programming concepts, even in the means in the interviews, recursive function concepts are asked, and lots of programming problems can be done only by using the recursive function concepts. If you don't use the recursive function concept, then that problem will be very difficult to solve. Okay, so one very good example of that was what? Finding the sum of series. So finding the sum of series is really difficult if you use a different approach. Okay. So next is there are some problems like Tower of Hanoi, and then we have binary searching. Okay. So these problems are only done by using recursive functions. So suppose that what is the recursive function we need to see by example. Suppose that we need to see we need to find gate sum of series up to n. Okay, now we know that sum of the series up to 1 is what? 1. Sum of the series up to 2 is what? 3. Sum of the series up to 4 is what? Sum of the series up to 3 is what? 6. Sum of the series up to 4 is what? 10. So this base condition we know already. Okay, so these are called as base conditions. So base condition is nothing. It is just the point where we know our value. Okay, so that's why we are writing def get sum of series. If n is equal to 0 or n is equal to 1, we know that the result should be 1. Okay, so return, note n is equal to 0, you can remove this n is equal to 0. If n is equal to 1, we know that the answer will be what? The answer will be 1. Okay, so that's, in that case we are returning 1, means otherwise return n plus sum of series n minus 1, means in the recursive function we divide our function in the way that means our program can be solved by dividing our function by dividing our program in the smaller parts. Okay, so this is a big task, and we are solving this big task by dividing this big task into this smaller tasks. Okay, so this concept is basically used in the recursive functions. Now you can see that this function will, what will happen if we call get sum of series up to 3, then what will happen? First it will try to find if n is equal to 1, so this condition is not true, then it will do what? It will return 3 plus get sum of series up to 2. Next this function will call again itself, so again it will check if n is equal to 1, so this is condition is not true, so it will return you what? 2 plus get sum of series up to 1. Next it will get sum of series up to 1, will return you 1, so now it will return you 3 plus 2 plus 1. Okay, so this is basically done by, so I am just showing you first a program for that. So def and then if sum of series, okay, up to n. So we know that if n is equal to 1, then we will return what? Then we will return what? 1. So this is what? So this is base condition, or it is also called as termination condition. Either you can call this as base condition or you can call this as termination condition. Now if n is not 1, then we will return what? Return n plus 8 sum of 3's up to n minus 1. Okay, so you can also write like that, if n is equal to 1, then return 1. So you can write more than one base condition. Okay, so like if we know that if n is equal to 2, we know that what? It should return what? 3. You can write more than one. If n is equal to 3, then we can write what? Return. The answer. What can we write here? If n is equal to 2, we are returning 3. Why? Because we know that sum of 3 is up to. So what is this? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. We know that the sum of the series up to 1 is what? 1. Sum of the series up to 2 is what? 3. Sum of the series up to 3 is what? 6. So we can return here 6. So more than one base condition you can write. Okay. Yes. So now if you call this get sum of series, we need to print the result also. Then get sum of series up to 5, then it will return you 15. We know that sum of the series up to 5 is what? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5, so it is 15. Okay, so I don't have a image here, but I want to show that. So that is an advanced topic, but I am just showing you. So just try to see this image. Okay, so this you can see that suppose that we are writing a program to calculate the factorial. Okay, so we know that what is this? If we are calling the factorial of 4, then it is returning 4 star factorial of 3. So then 4 star factorial of 3 will return 3 star factorial of 2. Then 3 star factorial of 2 will return 2 star factorial of 1. Next, this factorial 1 will return you what? 1. Now this base condition is not achieved. Then what will happen? So firstly it was going to forward, going to top. Okay, so these variables are basically, this is called a stack. Okay, if this is a stack, so firstly your at the end of the stack you have 4, with 4 as the result. 4 star means this is the result in the stack at the bottom, 4 star factorial 3. Next variable that was, next result that was present in the stack was 3 factorial 2. Now when you reach to the base condition, then what will happen? Every result will be not returned. So factorial 1 will be returned to this 2 star factorial 1 will be not 2 star 1. Now this 2 star factorial 1 will be returned to this factorial 2 was equal to that. Now it will return 3 star 2. Okay. Now this 3 star factorial 2 will return to here, and then it will give you 4 star factorial of 3. Now it will give you 4 star, so 6. So now this is called a stack concept in case of recursive function. So firstly it is getting, means first program does what? Program stores the result. Okay, when it finds the base condition, then it start reversing the result, and then the lower stack gets their values, and then it gives you the final result. So this is called a stacking concept in case of recursive function. Okay, so one very drawback of recursive function is what? It takes lots of memory. Whenever you use a recursive function, you can see that there are lots of variables that are stored in the memory as the temporary variables will be there. They will be stored in the memory. Okay, because we don't know their value. So suppose that if we write factorial 100, then there will be 99 variables present in the memory. When up to when we don't go to the base condition, means up to the base condition there will be 99 variables. Suppose that if you write find the factorial of 1000, then there will be 999 variables present in the memory for getting their value. So that's why if somebody write factorial of 1 lakh, then you can assume there will be how much variables in the program. Okay, so that's why recursive functions are very costly. We try to avoid using the recursive function. When should we use the recursive function? When we don't have any option, we need to find, maybe need to use only the, we have only the recursion. So if the program can be solved by only the recursive function, then we need to use, otherwise we try to avoid the recursive functions. Is this clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now I will try to give more example of recursive function in the next class. Okay. So now before, I just want to discuss on the project. So our first project is very exciting, means it's just a school handling school student database project. So I know all of you we all are familiar with the schools and what are schools student database, we all know. So there are following topics, so that means they are following sub project that we are going to complete. So first is record student data in a dictionary. Okay, so what are student data? I will show you. So first your task will be record student data into a dictionary. So currently this means if you go to the advanced section, means advanced section of this course, or means if you read somewhere else, if you join any different classes or any different course, then means this database basically will be a real database like SQL database, MongoDB database, or any database can be. SQLite means there are two types of database, means first is relational and second is called a non-relational database. So first is called as also SQL and second is called a NoSQL database. So there are two databases basically. So in the real world, these types of databases are used, but currently we don't have the knowledge of that, so that we will use our dictionary. So dictionary can also store the values. Okay. So we will record our student data into a dictionary. Next is join, remove, check the presence of a student, check gender. So these functions we will give the suppose that if a school administrator is using our project, then they should have the following option: to join a new student, to remove any student, to check the presence of a student, if particular student is present or not, and next is check gender. So what is the gender of the student, either he is a boy or she is a girl. Next is conduct an exam. So suppose that we want to conduct an exam between some particular students, and we want to, at the end we want to store the results of that. So we are giving this functionality to our school administrator. So this is our project, so handling school database. So now I'm explaining this as the program wise. Firstly, I told you that our students database will be a dictionary. So firstly, we should have a dictionary. So it will be like this, students. So this is a dictionary, and this students will be accessed by their roll number. So roll number will be the key of the, roll number will be the key of this dictionary. And then with this dictionary, with this roll number, we will have following information like name. Okay. And then with that we are passing the name as Anand, and then we have the information gender. Gender will be either M or F. Okay. Next is name, gender, and then class. Which class student is reading currently? Suppose that is in the class 10. So assume that we have 1 to 10 as the class. From 1, class is from 1 to 10. So this assumption you can have. So class is 10. So these, suppose that currently we have only this information: name, gender, and class. And this will be this will be linked to the roll number. So now we can have lots of students. Okay, so now I am modifying this student. So this is our just a sample student. So our student will be look like this. So suppose that this is roll number 1, 2, 3, and here we have Anand, and gender is M, the class is 10. Next is suppose that roll number 1, 2, 4, and we have here suppose that, okay, and gender is M, and this is suppose that gender is F, and then suppose that class is 7. Okay, so now your first task will be to give the option to remove, check the presence of students by roll number. And check the gender. So what they will do, so they will pass the roll number, and you need to print the gender of that. So first is what, join. So you need to write a method or a function. So first your task is what, write a function to add a new student in the dictionary. Okay, so if you want to add a new student in the dictionary, then what information you need to have from the user? Firstly, you will ask for the roll number, then you will ask for the name, then gender, then the class. So these four information you will ask from the user, then and only then you can insert that student into the database. Okay, second is what? Remove. So for removing, write a function to remove a student from the database by their roll number. So you will ask for the roll number of the student. If the roll number is present in the database, then you will delete that student from the database. If roll number is not present, then you should print a message to the user, to the administrator, that this particular roll number is not present in the database. Okay, next is check the presence of a student by roll number. So you can write it very simply, write a function to check presence of a student in the database by asking for roll number. Okay, so the fourth is check gender. So you need to do what? Write a function to print the gender based on roll number. You will not print like M and F. You will tell that this is output should be what? Output should be either boy, girl, or not found. Means either the student can be boy or girl, or you will say that if the roll number is not present, you will print that not found. Okay, so our next is conduct an exam. So this part I will discuss tomorrow. So now I need to take the second class. So do you have any doubt in this section? Hello? Do you have any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. So just try to start this project. Okay, so the next, only one thing is remaining, conduct an exam. So I will explain this tomorrow. Okay, so thank you everyone. Okay, bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, bye.